Nissan's N14 GTi-R is really one of the 90s JDM hero cars. We don't see too many of them, and we definitely don't see too many that are punching out 1,000 plus horsepower. We're here with Akin, owner of this GTi-R, to talk a little bit more about what makes it tick. So for a start, Akin, take us back to the early days of ownership of this car. What drew you to the GTi-R platform?
Being different is one of the main ones, and not a lot around. So I'm like, I have to get one of these.
How long have you actually owned it for, and what was the sort of modification level of it when you bought it?
It was fairly standard, and I've owned it for about 10 years now.
Okay, so obviously it's about as far from standard as we can get now. And a little anecdote before we get into this particular car, I actually owned one of these many years ago, and I've still got PTSD from, in stock form, just about everything you need to do except for swapping spark plugs requires you to take the engine and gearbox out, and it's a lot of work. So all power to you for getting it to this level. Let's talk about the engine combination for a start. So you're still SR20, but it's no normal SR20.
No, it's not. So we're running a Billet SR20 from Bullet Engineering with a P12 VE head on it, and it's been dry decked.
Okay, so this sounds like an all-out drag setup. It's also built for roll racing. With those billet blocks, the problem is whether you go a full dry block with no coolant in it, which makes it really drag only, or you can run a cooling system through it. Is this still street driven?
No, it's not. It's just solely for roll racing and drag racing at the moment.
But with the roll racing, you still need coolant so you can actually turn laps, correct?
Of course, yeah, we go around.
Okay. Talking about the cylinder heads, and I mean, from my own experience with our endurance car, the VE cylinder heads from the P11 and P12 Primera, really, they're a game changer for the SR20 platform. Can you talk us through some of the advantages of those heads?
The main advantage we've seen is the low-end power that we can bring on the turbo a lot earlier, and we're not dropping shims. So we can rev it to 11,000 pretty comfortably.
Yeah, try doing that with a regular SR20 DET head and it's not going to end too well. The difference there with the DE and DET heads is they had sort of a floating rocker arrangement. It was really, really heavy, and high RPM or an ignition cut would flick that rocker off and cause all sorts of carnage. Whereas the P11 and P12, the rocker is shaft mounted, so it literally can't get away on you. Now, my experience as well, massive improvement in flow with those VVL cylinder heads compared to the earlier heads?
Yes, definitely. Big difference.
What other modifications have you made to the head? Are you running aftermarket cams in it as well?
Yeah, we're running our custom PowerTune camshaft in it. We've got all the retainers, all the valves, all that done, and it's been CNC ported.
And for those who aren't sort of familiar with this cylinder head, it's kind of really Nissan's take on Honda's VTEC. However, particularly with high power output where the engine's only running at high RPM, a lot of people will basically eliminate the VVL or VTEC mechanism. Are you still retaining it?
No, we're still using it.
And that's an advantage for the bottom end performance?
Correct, yeah, because we're running such a large turbo on it.
In terms of the dry decking that you mentioned, can you tell us in simple terms what that actually means and why you've gone that route?
Okay, so the passage between the head and the block is blocked off essentially, so we can run high boost levels and not, you know, lifting the head up.
So this is the water passages from the block into the cylinder head. Normally that's where the water passes through, so you've stopped that and you're routing that externally between the head and the block?
Correct, yeah, with electric water pump and all that.
An advantage there is, as you mentioned there, if you do happen to lift the head, you're not going to end up with water getting out and under the tyres. So it's a safety consideration.
100%.
Another aspect with all of these high boost, small capacity turbocharged engines is head gasket integrity. Basically, keeping the head on the block. What are you running in terms of head studs and head gasket solution?
Well, that's all with the Bullet engineering. It's got the head studs with it. We're running a fire ring and a copper head gasket.
Okay. And pretty well bulletproof then?
Yeah, pretty much bulletproof.
Now the engine's there essentially just to sort of maintain the power levels or support the power levels. It's the turbo that really pushes the air into the engine. So that's another key element in this whole package. So what is the turbo that you're running?
It's a Precision 7275. Yeah, that's it.
Okay, boost levels and power that it's actually producing?
45 PSI with nitrous, it makes about 1200 horsepower.
And we're talking here at the wheels or this flywheel?
At the hubs.
Okay, that is a huge amount of power. getting that to the track must be pretty challenging. So you're using it for roll racing and drag racing. We haven't talked times yet, so I know you're more involved now with the roll racing, but just so we've got a bit of a benchmark here, what's the quarter mile time that you've done in it?
It's done a 9.2 at 163 miles.
Pretty impressive for a GTI. I'd say that's got to be close to a world record. I'm not too sure. Someone will probably correct us in the comments.
Yeah.
In terms of the power delivery, what are you doing for roll racing and drag racing as the car goes down the strip? I'm guessing you're not leaving the line with 1200 wheel horsepower. It's just going to go up in smoke. So do you do time-based, speed-based, or gear-based boost control?
We do all of the above, pretty much. We control every aspect of the motor to get to do a good launch.
And that really brings us to the heart of controlling this. What are the electronics that you're running in the car?
We're running a MoTeC system, pretty much front to back. It's all been rewired, PDMs, MoTeC dash, MoTeC, everything.
Okay. Much. Now, the drivetrain in the GTi-R is probably in stock form one of the really limiting factors. It was a little bit fragile, even relatively stock form. Clearly, it's not going to be up to 1200 wheel horsepower. So talk us through what you've done there.
We've PowerTune, we've come up with a EVO conversion. So we're running an EVO gearbox and it's a Holinger sequential we're running.
So the element here is obviously the GTi-R is a relatively niche car. So not a lot of off the shelf solutions in terms of better gearboxes. So that's why you went the EVO route?
Yeah, definitely.
What's involved in that conversion? And is this something that PowerTune would offer to other GTi-R customers?
Yes, definitely. It's an off the shelf market. Adapter plate and kit pretty much to put it straight in.
So it still retains the stock Holinger EVO bell housing. It's adapter plate between the Holinger and the SR20 block?
Yes, correct.
Okay, what about the rest of the drivetrain? What about the rear end?
We're running a GTi-R rear end on it, R200, and all the hubs have been changed so we can run bigger axles.
Okay, so pretty well bulletproof now?
Pretty much.
Let's go back to another aspect you mentioned, which is the nitrous. So how are you using the nitrous? Is this just for sort of anti-lag or spool on a two-step, or are you actually also running it down the track?
We're running it down low so we can bring the turbo on a bit earlier, and we're running it up top as well if we need it.
And is this something that you are controlling as the driver, or is this automated through the MoTeC ECU?
It's all done through the MoTeC.
Makes it nice and easy. What about the fuel system that you're running in here? We haven't actually talked about the fuel. I'm going to guess E85, but is it something a little bit more exotic?
No, we're running E85, pump E85, and we've got a mechanical fuel pump to keep up with the fuel supply.
Okay, so that mechanical pump, 1200 horsepower at the wheels, it's a lot, but it's probably not outside the realms of what we can do now with brushless pumps. Why was the decision made to run that mechanical pump?
Just to keep it simple.
You've still got an electronic pump feeding fuel, or electric pump, I should say, feeding fuel forward to the mechanical pump. I mean, one of the problems we see with mechanical pumps is, particularly at cranking speed, they can struggle to build pressure, so it can be quite hard to get the car started. So how are you dealing with that?
So we got a pump in the tank that's supplying to the surge tank at the front, which is supplying the mechanical pump.
So nice and easy, no problems getting it to start.
No problems at all.
Okay. Now, are you intending to head back to the drag strip and try and better that time? You're so close to the 8-second zone. I can imagine there's a bit of a carrot there for you, or is it now just pure roll race?
We're definitely going to try this year for an 8-second pass.
All right, Akin, great to get some insight into the car. Thanks for your time, and we do wish you all the best aiming for that 8.
No problem. Thank you.
Like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up, and if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week, and if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.